Welcome back. I want to invite everybody to come in and to take your seats, to grab your Bibles. If you didn't bring a Bible with you this morning, we do have Bibles at the table there by the back doors. You're welcome to grab one of those. If you don't own a Bible, that would be our gift to you. We'd love for you to take that home and to make that your own. Well, as you grab your Bibles, please turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 1. This morning, we're going to be looking at three verses, verses 12 through 14 of Acts chapter 1. Please join me now in praying for the preaching, for the reading of God's word. Well, Father in heaven, we gather together this morning, eager to praise your name, to bless your name, Father, for we are here this morning because of you, Father. As we sing, all we have is Christ, Father. We are here this morning, counted righteous in your sight because of the blood of your Son, Jesus. Because he lived the life that we're called to live. He died the death that we deserve to pay our penalty, that we might be counted righteous, robed in the robe of righteousness that he purchased with his blood. So, Father, we are here this morning because of you. And we look to you now, Father. We gather together to hear your word, you speaking to us, Father. So I pray that you would do that. I pray, Father, that you would help me to speak accurately, clearly, boldly, powerfully, Father, from your word. And attend the preaching of your word and attend the listening of your word with your Holy Spirit, Father. I pray, God, I pray that you would help us, Lord, to hear you speaking to us, to hear you counseling us, hear you strengthening us and showing us your way, your will for our lives. Let us leave here today, Father, with greater hope, with greater encouragement and faith for what you are doing in and through this church and in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, over the last few weeks, we have started a new book, the book of Acts, that we've been very eager to begin with you as your pastoral team. We've been eager to study the book of Acts for a long time for a number of reasons. First of all, because it is God's word. We are a church that gathers together, as we just prayed, to study God's word. It is the story of the advancing gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the story of the early church. In it, we see God's ordinary people being used for extraordinary purposes. In it, we see what kind of community God formed from redeemed men and women and children from all kinds of backgrounds. In the book of Acts, we find the clearest picture of the priorities of the early church. We have these little windows that we get to peer in and see the church doing different things that God formed it to do. We see God working through them. As my sons will tell you, they love the book of Acts because it's all about action. It's the book of the New Testament where all sorts of stuff happens through the people of God. It's an exhilarating, fast-paced, edge-of-your-seat kind of book that is packed full of energy and activity from start to finish. Massive revivals, signs and wonders, earthquakes, jailbreaks, snake bites, miracles and healings, church members falling dead because they lied to the Spirit. We read about missionaries, enemies of the gospel, heroes of the faith, murders, and shipwrecks. We see in it the dead are raised to life and more, all packed in 28 chapters of the book before us called Acts. And this morning we look at three verses. Before all of this exhilarating, edge of your seat, nonstop action begins, we have the calm before the storm, as it were. This week I took my family camping and it rained a lot, but there were lots of pockets of sunshine and non-rain, and any time that the rain was coming in, you could see, you know, we're out in the middle of, you know, of nowhere, so you could see the storm clouds coming in, and you saw the rain and you knew that chaos was about to ensue. But before it did, it was quiet. There was no wind and all was calm. And that's what we have this morning. Here we have a group of believers who had just witnessed, as we heard last week, the ascension of their Lord Jesus Christ. And they're personally commissioned by him to a life of making Jesus known to the ends of the earth. Great things are about to ensue, but before they get to that, Jesus tells them to wait. They wait, and their waiting is like the still winds while you watch the storm rolling in. It's still, and there is little action, but you know that it's all about to change. That's what we see in this passage this morning. It's the calm before the storm. Jesus, the one for whom all of Israel had been eagerly waiting for thousands of years, finally shows up on the scene. He lives a perfect life, fulfilling all the righteous requirements of God. He dies the perfect death on our behalf, and then he raises from the dead to defeat the power of death and sin forever. We saw in the first section of Acts these last couple weeks that he then appeared to his disciples for 40 days, and he tells them, here it is, he tells them, you are going to be my witnesses to the ends of the earth in Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth. I have a global mission for you, something humongous for you to do that is impossible from a human perspective. You've been waiting thousands of years. Everything, now go, I want you to go and tell everyone that I've come. Go and tell all that you've seen. Go change the world. But first, wait. What? Wait. Tells them to wait. It tells them to return to Jerusalem. Go and do all this, but wait. First, return to Jerusalem. I'm going to send you my Spirit, and he will empower you for this mission, for my glory. So as they wait, they're anything but inactive. They're not sitting there passive. They're not just inactive. They are gathering together and praying. In the book of Acts, as we mentioned, we're able to kind of look in this window and see the early church and what they were doing. And what we see is how God was preparing them for the mission that he had called them to. We see the type of community that is used greatly by God. These disciples, these men and women and children were greatly used by God. And if we want to be greatly used by God, if we read about the book of Acts and think, how amazing would that have been to be part of that back then? If we want to be used by God the way that these early believers were used by God, well, then we have much to learn from this passage of God's word and from this window, from this description of God's people. And what we will see is that the people the most used by God are those who wait for him and call out to him together. They were devoting themselves to prayer together. And in doing that, they experienced unity. And in doing that, they experienced power. And God's grace and glory abounded in and through their little community. What we need to see is that great works of God often begin in very small places with small groups of people humbling themselves and praying to him. What I want us to take away this morning is that just like this first group of Christians, we are called to pray together for the gospel to advance in our midst. So let's read the section of scripture. We're going to read the text and look at it and address that from different perspectives. Then we want to talk about how we want to apply that in our church together. So read with me in Acts chapter 1, verses 12 through 14. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And when they had entered, they went up to the upper room where they were staying. Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. All these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brothers. So set before them is the biggest mission in the history of the world, the one that God's people had been waiting thousands of years for. Jesus has risen from death. Go tell the world, but first go back to Jerusalem and wait. The apostles' immediate duty was plain to them. Jesus told them what to do. Go to Jerusalem and wait. And so they returned to the city. They, in obedience to the Lord, in an anticipation of what is to follow, they have returned to Jerusalem and they wait together. They go to the upper room where they were staying. And here we get a list of names. We get a picture of who is there. The upper room wouldn't have been a large room. It would have been like the top part of a house or something, a small room, certainly smaller than what we have here. And in it, we have this list, these 11 apostles without one, without Judas, the betrayer. We have this other guy that was unfortunately also named Judas that for the rest of his life had to explain that. No, I'm the other one. I'm the brother of James. Along with the 11 apostles, we have the brothers of Jesus who once were skeptical of their brothers' claims of divinity, and now we find them counted among the believers. So something happens from the moment where, you know, when Jesus is with them, he's telling his brothers, I am God. They say, nah, you're just our brother. And something changes when he dies, when he raises from the dead, something changes, and now they are with the believers. And also, among this small group are the women. Women are prominently featured here, which is significant. Luke goes to great pains in his gospel and in the book of Acts to give women a prominent place, which was countercultural in his day. We see women were with Jesus, ministering to him and following him among his disciples throughout his ministry on earth. They were also prominently featured on the days of his death and his resurrection. So it's not surprising to find them here as well. So we've got the 11 disciples, some women, and the brothers of Jesus, not a super impressive crowd. And yet this group of people, these fishermen and women, all unlearned and unimpressive people in the eyes of the world. This fledgling group of people is the group of people that God used to turn the world, as the book of Acts says, upside down. They turned the world upside down. And that's a lesson for us this morning that gives us hope and faith, is that God delights in taking ordinary, average, unimpressive people and doing amazing and unimaginable things through them. People like you and me. If there's anything that we learn from the book of Acts, it's that God can take the seemingly weak and insignificant and to do great things through them. We are each here this morning aware of our weakness, aware of our frailty. We are aware of our limitations. But in our weakness, we must know that there is one who is strong. We've said it before. John has said it many times, that our weakness is the greatest platform to display God's greatness. There is one who can do great things, and that is the story of the book of Acts. The book of Acts is not ultimately about a group of people, but it's about their God. It's about our God. And may it be the story of our lives as well. So, how does a room full of ordinary, seemingly insignificant and weak, limited people turn the world upside down? Well, the first thing that Luke draws our attention to, the first thing that Luke tells us about their life together, as we look in this window, is that recognizing their weakness, recognizing their need and their utter dependence, the church prayed together, and they prayed together dependently. So that's point one, is that the church prays dependently. Luke's first summary of the life and activities of the followers of Jesus. What does he want to say first and foremost about this group of people as he draws our attention to their life together post-resurrection, post-ascension of Jesus? The first thing that Luke draws our attention to is that they were a church that prayed together in dependence on God. Their attention is not focused on themselves or their work, but on God, whose power alone sustains their life and assists them and empowers them for the mission that they are called to do. They weren't gathering for just any purpose that they could accomplish on their own. As John prayed earlier, we don't gather each week to do what we alone can do, what we alone can accomplish. We gather together to experience the supernatural work of our God in us and through us every week. We don't gather together and serve in various ways and give up our finances just to have a nice meeting. No, we want to see the advance of the gospel. And while certainly we can do a lot of things on our own, we can't change a single heart. We can't restore a broken marriage. We can't bring the dead from life apart from divine intervention. And so we pray in dependence. Bible scholar and commentator Thomas Schreiner says clearly, in Luke and Acts, there is a close connection between the advance of the kingdom and prayer. The kingdom does not arrive through human invention or contrivance. Rather, it is a stunning and miraculous work of God. And the prayer of the early church signaled absolute dependence on him. So you have this fledgling group of believers, but they had been with the Lord Jesus for years now. They had listened to him. They had been with him. Surely there is a lot of confidence that comes along with that. Surely if there was a group of people who said, I can do this, I can just, you know, fly, you know, shoot from the hip here, it was this group of people. And instead of saying, hey, we've got this, we've been with the Lord Jesus, who are you to tell us? No, they humbled themselves in prayer. They acknowledged their weakness and the limitations and their dependence upon him, and so should we. So the first thing I want you to see in this text is that prayer is that the church prays dependently, that prayer recognizes complete and utter dependence upon God. Their prayer, the prayer of the early church, was an admission of need, asking God to do for them what they cannot do for themselves. And so it is for us. We want to ask God to do for us and through us what we cannot do on our own, what we cannot do for ourselves. The disciples, they were told that before they set on a mission, they had to wait for the empowering of the Holy Spirit. So they knew from the outset that they were called to do something that they simply could not accomplish on their own apart from God's help. And that's us as well. This year, by God's grace, as your pastoral team, we have asked the Lord, we're asking the Lord together to grow us in this regard. We're asking God to allow us to be part of the advancing gospel of Jesus Christ here in our community, in this church, and in this neighborhood, in the neighborhoods that we all live in our workplaces, in our families. We want to see the advancing gospel of Jesus Christ. We want to grow in the area of evangelism. We want to grow in the ability to live and to speak the gospel, to display the power of God, to display the power of the gospel in our marriages, in our lives, and with our words. So John mentioned we have this proclaimant here that we're going to go through in the life of our church through our small groups for the next couple of months. And this is an area that we just want to confess our weakness. Confess our need. You've heard John pray for God to raise up evangelists among us because we feel our weakness. Every one of us is intimidated when we think about knocking on our next door neighbor's door or talking to our boss at work or inviting our brother to church who hasn't darkened the doors in decades. But in order to do this, we need help. We need God to work in us and through us. Like the early church, we need God to send his Spirit for us. So before we do anything else, before we just rush through programs and create initiatives to go and tell, and we want to do that, but we always want to do that in dependence upon God. Before we do anything else with praise or petition, thanksgiving or intercession, we utterly depend on him in whose sovereignty we trust. And this emphasizes the significance of the work of the Holy Spirit for the life and the ministry of the church. Why were the apostles effective in their ministry? Why were they effective in their mission work? They were empowered by the same Spirit that is available to you and to me. It wasn't their organizational skills or their rhetorical abilities that explained the growth of the church. Rather, the presence of God himself and of the risen Jesus Christ in their life and ministry. Friends, the good news about this is that while this early church gathered and waited for the sending of the Spirit, we are not waiting for the Spirit to be sent. The Spirit has come. The Spirit indwells every person who confesses the name of Jesus Christ. Every person who's been converted from death to life is indwelt by the power of the Holy Spirit. So the Spirit that they anticipated, we experience. Certainly, we want to be filled with the Spirit on a daily, regular, ongoing, being filled basis. But we have the good news that the Spirit dwells inside us even now, even praying for us and through us when we can't find the words. So the first thing this morning is the church prays dependently. Recognizing our dependence, we go to him in prayer. Secondly, the church prays persistently. You have this phrase here that they were devoting themselves to prayer. Well, the word here for devoting could be understood as persistent or continuous, busily engaged in. The church that prayed in Jerusalem was praying persistently. They were devoting themselves to it. It was prayer that prevailed. This is what happens today as well. The Lord sometimes gives a burden to someone or a small group of people. You experience this. Sometimes you may have a burden to pray and you go and grab one of your friends, someone from your small group, or one of the pastors or leaders of the church, and you say, would you join me in praying for this? This morning, as we do each week, we had our corporate prayer time before this meeting that I would love to see. I want to invite you to. This is not a pastor's prayer meeting or leader's prayer meeting or a men's prayer meeting. It is for the entire church. Young and old, my children come to the prayer meeting with me. They pray alongside us. Often I am humbled by the prayers of the children that are in that room. So come to the prayer meeting. This morning, while we were praying, someone shared a burden that was not on our prayer agenda and said, please join with me in praying for this. And so we spent time praying for that. And then some of us wrote that down and said, I want to go and pray for that later and follow up on that. And often that's what the Lord does. And so we pray over something for an extended period of time. And with time, we find that the Lord has wonderfully answered our prayers. You've all seen this in your own lives. It's a simple principle, but one that we must be regularly reminded of, given our natural tendency to drift to prayerlessness, is that often our burdens to pray start small and with a small group of people, and they grow, and then we see God responding. Again, Thomas Schreiner says of this section, he says, in Acts, the disciples pray for the coming of the kingdom, for the coming of the Spirit with power. Such prayers were geared then to the spread of the gospel to the ends of the earth, and so that the worldwide blessing promised in the Old Testament would be realized. There was a keen recognition that their courage would last and the word would spread only if God strengthened them. And hence, the members of the early church devoted themselves to prayer. They devoted themselves to prayer. Would you say that you are a person who is devoted to prayer? Are you looking for opportunities to pray throughout your day? Are you gathering moments where you see someone in the hall and they share a burden with you and you say, well, let's just stop right now and pray? Are you looking for moments where I love getting these emails from you, dear friends. I received an email a few weeks ago from one of the members of this church who said, we're going to gather at our house to pray. And so they invited a number of people. They invited John and I and said, we just want to gather together to pray. It wasn't a scheduled church organized prayer meeting. It was just people saying, we need God to work. So they were devoted to prayer. They prayed persistently. Just to spell out a little more how devoted the early church was to prayer, consider for a moment that the book of Acts has 28 chapters, and 21 of them, it is said that the early church was praying together. There are 31 references to prayer in the book of Acts alone. Just to give you a taste, in Acts chapter 1, next week we will look at the fact that the early church prayed together for the replacement of Judas. In Acts chapter 2, the new church devotes itself to prayer, responding to Pentecost. In Acts chapter 4, they gather to praise God for Peter and John's release from the rulers and the elders of Jerusalem and answer their prayers. In Acts chapter 8, the disciples prayed together for the Spirit to fall upon the Samaritans. In Acts chapter 12, the church prays together for Peter's rescue from Herod. In Acts chapter 13, the church at Antioch prays together to commission Saul and Barnabas. In Acts chapter 14, the church prayed while appointing elders for the church and committing them to the Lord. In Acts chapter 16, we find the devout women of Philippi praying by the river along with Paul and Silas. In Acts 21, the disciples prayed together with their wives and children as Paul set sail for Jerusalem. I could go on and on and on. I could remind you of other sections of the scripture. We just finished a series in the book of Daniel. In the book of Daniel, multiple times they gathered together to pray persistently for the Lord to work in and through their midst. The early church was a church devoted to prayer. They prayed persistently. One way that we can grow in the area of praying persistently, because I know if you're like me, prayer, like evangelism, two topics that we're talking about this morning, cause great fear and trepidation. They just bring about, there's a form that I fill out regularly for categories in the Christian life that I want to grow in and I want to have others hold me accountable to. And these are categories, prayer and evangelism, that I'm regularly chalking. I just feel condemnation. I'm aware of my weakness and my failure. One way that we can grow in faithfulness in this regard and praying persistently is to pray according to the scriptures. This is a practice that I was first introduced to by D.A. Carson's book, Spiritual Reformation. I brought it this morning. I think it has a new cover, but this is a fantastic book. If you're looking for a book to grow your prayer life, Spiritual Reformation by D.A. Carson, he goes through the prayers of the Apostle Paul, and he just studies them and draws from them, and how can we pray like Paul did? Praying according to Scripture causes us to look beyond our present experience and to yearn for the fullness of God that he wants us to experience. And in turn, this stimulates persistent prayer. When we pray the scriptures, our prayers grow in passion and expression. We begin to think more and more God's thoughts after him. More and more our prayers turn from a medical list of friends that we know that need physical healing or certain things that certainly are good to pray for. We want to pray for this. We want to pray for healing. But we want to pray for other things as well, beyond our present circumstances, for the fullness of God. We want to pray for revival. We want to pray for revival among the church, here in this church and in the churches around us, across the country and around the world. We want to pray for God to move among his people and to revive our hearts. The history of the church demonstrates that revival only comes after the persistent prayer of the people of God. J. Edwin Orr said that no great spiritual awakening has begun anywhere in the world apart from united prayer. Christians praying persistently for revival. Again, often these begin with people like you and me, or our children, or a friend, someone who has a burden that may not even be shared by others, but triggers persistent prayer in their own private life. You may be familiar with the story of George Mueller, and examples of prayer, answered prayer from his life abound. We could spend our time fruitfully this morning just reading through examples of answered prayer in the life of George Mueller. In November of 1844, George Mueller began to pray for the conversion of 5 individuals. This is small. It's not a huge request when you think about the thousands that we're going to hear about converted daily, in the early church. He was praying for 5 individuals. Mueller says, "I prayed every day without one single intermission, whether sick or in health, on the land or on the sea, and whatever the pressure of my engagements might be." After 18 months of such praying, the first of the 5 was converted. Hallelujah. 5 years later, the second was converted. After 6 years, the third was converted. In his sermon, Mueller said that he had been praying for 36 years for the final 2. 36 years. How long have you been praying for your father, your mother, or your brother, or your friend, and seeing no fruit? Mueller prayed for 36 years for the other 2, but they still remained unconverted. His biographer says that one of the 2 became Christian before Mueller died, and the other just a few years after Mueller's death. God answered his prayers for these 5 individuals because of his persistent prayer for them. Often, as in the case of an adult but rebellious child or an unconverted spouse, we can do little to directly change the person. We need God's help. Advice and rebuke may only make the matter worse. But we can persevere in prayer for them. We can pray for them persistently before our Father. History is replete with examples from just such prayers like this. One of the great agonies of sermon preparation is what's called the cutting room floor. It's always relieving to me that you don't know what was left on the floor. But it pains me to know of all the stories and all the examples in Scripture and in church history that I don't have time, that we don't have time to look at this morning. But those examples abound. So we want to pray according to Scripture. We want to pray for revival. Another way to cultivate a persistent prayer life is to pray for your fellow members in the church. One of the greatest tools of ministry that we have in the church, I want to introduce you to this. The members of the church have this. It is our prayer, our membership directory. Let's call it our prayer journal, prayer guide, because it is that. This is one of the greatest tools of ministry. This is the membership directory that has a list of all the members of the church and our children. And one of the great things that you can do is to take time to simply pray through this. I carry this with me wherever I go. I just keep it in my truck, and because I work out of my truck, I'm kind of always around, and I'm sitting in a stoplight, and I just pick it up, and I see a name, and I start praying for that family. Or if I when I have my time in the morning of devotional time, I might take time there to pray for that family. Or as I see someone, or I know I'm going to meet with someone, I want to pick up that, and I just want to spend time praying for them. This is a great practice that I would encourage you to do. One of the great things on this, you may find names on here that you don't know very well. Our church is big enough. It's not that big, but it's big enough that we come on Sunday mornings, and whether it's new folks or people that have been around for a year that you just haven't met yet, you see people that you don't know, and you see names on this list that you don't know. And sometimes it might feel a little awkward or weird to pray for someone you don't know. Or you come together in our prayer time on Sunday mornings, and each Sunday, we take time to pray through the membership directory. So we have names that we're praying for. We prayed for four different families among that are sitting here this morning by name, specific ways. You might not know those names, but keep in mind that Paul didn't know the Roman Christians by name, not all of them, certainly. He hadn't even met them when he wrote the book. And yet, he prayed for them simply because they were brothers and sisters in the faith. It is a wonderfully God-honoring thing to invest time in prayer for your brothers and sisters in the faith, to pray for those sitting in this room, to pray for those in the church, to pray for those in other churches, to pray for those around the world, certainly, especially for those that we are covenanted together with. And without knowing about their particular circumstances, without knowing them at all, without being able to spot their face in the crowd, and we are working on a photo directory, by the way. So by God's grace, hopefully we'll have that at some point. Our membership directory will have pictures, so it's easier to identify people. But without knowing their particular circumstances, the funny thing is that we often pray bigger prayers for them. Instead of simply praying, this morning we prayed for a friend who had a ruptured eardrum. And that's a good thing to pray for. We want to pray for his healing, absolutely. But if you don't know somebody, you may simply pray for God to be glorified in their marriage and for their children to come to know the Lord and for God to do amazing and marvelous things through the midst. That is not a small prayer. Those are great, wonderful prayers to pray for people that you may not know very well. And as a side benefit, as you pray for people you don't know very well, you will come to learn their names. And then when you engage with them, you will be able to talk to them of your prayers for them. So the church prays dependently, the church prays persistently, and finally, the church prays corporately. The thing that I want to call attention to most this morning about the quality of the community of the early church is that they are united in corporate prayer. Certainly, we are called to private lives of prayer. We're called to pray privately in the prayer closet. We are called to pray where no one sees us. It's been said that what a man is on his knees before the Lord alone, that he is and no more. And that's true. But the church was devoted to prayer corporately together. What is the most defining aspect of their community? They are united in prayer together. If you read this passage and ask, what is the main thing that defines this community? What is the main thing that they are doing as they wait? What is the main thing they're doing throughout the book of Acts? What is the main thing that we're told again and again that they're devoted to, that they're giving themselves to? Verse 14, all these with one accord were devoting themselves to prayer. Devoting themselves to prayer. Prayer. All these, not just some, all these with one accord. That's unity. They were devoting themselves to prayer. So the picture of these early believers is one in which they were gathered together like we are this morning. They were united together. They were praying passionately together. They were pouring out their hearts together in prayer. Devoted together means more than just simply in the same room. It says with one accord. So it's not just physical proximity, but rather communicates a shared heart and a shared mind. They were saying amen. They were agreeing with one another in prayer. As one prays, someone else carries it forward. Someone else adds their amen. Someone adds to the prayer. Yes, God, and also do this. Yes, Father, and as we seek to grow in this regard, yes, Father, as we seek to grow, as we seek to experience the advancing gospel of Jesus Christ in our midst, also do this. Jesus said in Matthew 18, if two of you on earth agree about anything that you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. My children know this. They often will individually come and ask for something, and I'm always eager to grant whatever request, but usually when they come in packs, all asking for the same thing, it is such a great joy to answer that request. And so it is with our Father. The prayer talked about here in Acts 1 is group prayer. They were all joined together constantly. Often, again, great prayer movements begin with a burden of a single individual that they share with others, and then they keep on praying with them until the blessing comes. In the 1850s, for example, the United States was in a very weak spiritual state. Christians looked around and they did not see a Christian nation. They saw weakness and they saw spiritual apathy. They saw nominalism. People were preoccupied with a concern for material things, not unlike today. In 1857, a quiet 46-year-old businessman named Jeremiah Lanphier felt led to start a noonday weekly prayer meeting, once a week, from noon to 1 o'clock. He was walking along the street and he said, I think we should start gathering together for prayer. I just want to gather some people together for prayer. Not sure what exactly he hoped would happen. Anyone could attend for a few minutes or the entire hour, much like our weekly prayer meeting. On the first day, Lanphier prayed all by himself for the first half hour. So halfway through, he's by himself, not a great success. And yet, at the end of the hour, there were 6 men from 4 different churches who had joined him, praying together. The next week came 20 and 40 the week after. Soon they decided to meet every day, and the group swelled to over 100 people praying together every day from noon to 1 o'clock. Pastors who came started morning prayer meetings in their own churches. Soon similar meetings were being held all over America. Within 6 months, there were more than 10,000 people meeting daily in New York City alone. This was the story of what is now termed the Great Awakening in North America. Started with one man. It is estimated that in a 2-year period, from 1857 to 1859, 2 million people were led to Christ out of a population of 30 million. 2 million people, and it started with this guy saying, I'm going to start a once a week, 1 hour prayer meeting, and it's going to be sorry, the first week I'm going to show up all by myself. I'm going to pray. Praying together, friends, does a number of things. Praying together fosters unity. We see that they're praying together with one accord in unity. It's difficult to pray together not to grow in your affection for one another and in your unity together, your sympathy for one another. Prayer together is also a form of discipleship. There are wonderful things that happen. If you want to grow in discipling other people, just gather them to pray. And you will be discipling them. They will be discipling you. We strengthen one another and sharpen one another in our prayer. Jesus prayed in John 11 for the explicit purpose that his prayer would be an instrument of sanctification, of discipleship in the lives of his disciples. He wanted to increase their faith. That happens every time that I pray. This morning I prayed and Sam was praying in the room, and as he prays, I want to pray more like him. I hear a man who knows the Lord. My faith is strengthened and built up. Samuel Miller gives an account of a minister who prayed during a service with what he called importunate, touching devotion. So I read old books to learn words like importunate. Afterward, a woman stopped on her way out the door to say, that man prayed as if he lives at the throne of grace. often we don't know what it's like to live at the throne of grace until we pray together with someone who does. Have you ever been in a prayer meeting where someone prayed with that kind of confidence, that kind of authority, that kind of boldness, that kind of intimacy, that you said, I want to know my God like that guy does. I want to dwell at the throne of grace like him. When we pray together, we are growing together, sharpening one another's lives and prayers in our faith. By praying corporately, we emphasize spiritual priorities over merely physical circumstances. We emphasize our life together corporately over simply our needs as individuals, that we pray for those. Cannot preach on prayer without referencing and quoting extensively from Charles Haddon Spurgeon, one of our heroes of the faith. Charles Spurgeon, there are, again, like Mueller, stories and examples that abound about what happened in the basement of his church in the prayer meetings there. He said nothing happened apart from the prayers of the saints below the church. And books have been written about his prayer life and the prayer life of his church. So I want to quote one thing from Charles Spurgeon this morning. He says, but again, united prayer, that is corporate prayer, praying together, is useful inasmuch as God has promised extraordinary and peculiar blessings in connection with it. Wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. If two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. God asks agreement, and once the saints agree, he pledges himself that the prayer of his agreeing ones shall be answered. Why? See what accumulated force there is in prayer. When one after another pours out his vehement desires, when many seem to be tugging at the rope, when many seem to be knocking mercy's gate, when the mighty cries of many burning hearts come up to heaven. When, my beloved, you go up and shake the very gates thereof with the powerful battering ram of a holy vehemence and a sacred importunity, then it is that the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence. When first one and then another throws his whole soul into the prayer, the kingdom of heaven is conquered, and then the victory becomes great indeed. There was much to do, friends, for the early church in their gospel proclaiming, bread breaking, widow feeding, church planting work. And yet the first thing that they give themselves to and the things that they devote themselves to time and again is praying together. They were praying together when they arrived and when they departed. They prayed together when they were sick and in prison, but also when they were simply sitting down for a meal. They prayed together in their formal worship services in the temple and at the riverside prayer meetings. We pray together in corporate prayer meetings that are organized by the church. And then this week, I prayed together with a group of people by a campfire under the stars. We pray together all the time. We pray together in the hall and on the phone. The apostles prayed together. Men, women, and children prayed together. They prayed for the Spirit, for protection, for boldness in the proclamation of the gospel. They prayed for one another's unique personal circumstances. Wherever the gospel went, wherever churches were established, God's people were praying together. Brothers and sisters, if we want to see the advancing gospel of Jesus Christ go forth in our midst, if we want to see marriages, broken marriages restored, if we want to see children saved, if we want to see neighbors and loved ones come to know our Savior, can we expect that the Lord will do it in a different way other than how he's done it for thousands of years throughout all of church history? Can we honestly think that today we ought to be any different, that our life together should be any different? We ought to find ourselves praying together deliberately and fervently whenever we can. This means whether we gather on Sundays or chatting in the hall, you find out about the bad medical report, or you hear about the son who's gone astray, or you hear about the father who has never known the Lord, who has never conversed the Savior. We just stop and pray right then. I have many friends that I will share a need with them on the phone, and they will just say quickly, you know what, can I just stop and pray for you right now? And that means the world to me. Not simply, hey, I'll pray for you. That's meaningful. It's not to diminish that. We want to pray for people. I want to write things down and go and pray for them. But it's so powerful to seize that moment right there and to just pray with them. It's important, like my friend, like, you know, the email I told you about, you know, a few weeks ago, where someone emailed me and said, hey, we're just going to gather together these four families. We're just going to spend some time praying together for these certain things. So we want to be praying together. The reason that we want to pray together, the church, is because we see this as a priority from God. We want to be a church that is devoted to God, to prayer. We want to have a church that is committed to joining our hearts in unison as these early disciples did, praying persistently, praying dependently, praying corporately. The quality and the strength of our church community certainly plays a critical role in the advance of the gospel in the book of Acts. And the same is true today. When people come into our midst, when we invite unbelievers into our midst, what they experience here in this room and in that prayer meeting, in that prayer room, what they experience in our small groups, all of it plays a critical role in the advance of the gospel. There's a link between the health and the prayerfulness and the unity of the church and the advance of the gospel. What you see is if you don't have unity, maturity, and holiness, then it's impossible to grow together as a church in a way that is pleasing to God. But in order to accomplish these things, we need God to work. So we pray. Here's the thing. On our own, we can't replicate the outpouring of God's blessing in the early churches. We read through the book of Acts. We may read about the thousands of believers, and it's hard to relate. And we can't replicate that on our own. But what we can do, what we can replicate, friends, we can replicate their example. We can replicate their community life. We can replicate their prayer life and plead with the Lord of mercy to do in us what he did through them. So brothers and sisters, in closing, we come to prayer meetings painfully aware that our faith and our obedience and our prayers aren't what they should be. We're aware of all of these things. But when we come together to pray, we pray not because we're healthy, but because we're sick. Not because we're strong, but because we're weak. Not because we have it all together, but because we're needy. Not because we're rich, but because we're poor. We're not powerful, but we know the one who is. We together stumble into prayer meetings and find joy of joys that Christ himself meets us. He is waiting for us there. His Spirit intercedes with us and for us and through us. We come together as dependent creatures, eager to experience the supernatural power of God. Praying together, friends, is for you and me. It's for our children. You, suffering one, may be the next person to call friends to pray at your bedside. Think about this. So we have friends like this who spend most of their days in bed, unable to move, in pain. And the Lord may use that individual. Maybe that person is here or is listening to this, who just simply gathers people together saying, please pray for me. All I have to offer is my weakness and my need. And the Lord may use that to spark revival. Children in the room are not excused from this. Jesus welcomed the children and said, let the children come. Do not hinder them. You children may be a child in that long line of ordinary children whose prayers bring grown-ups to their knees. This happens to me all the time. My son was praying for me this morning as I was preparing to preach, and he prayed great prayers that humble me. You, dear church, may be in that great company of praying men and women whose names disappear completely from the history books, but who will be remembered forever in heaven. And one day will be greeted by saints in other countries and other lands and other times that you prayed for. Future saints, think about the people that we're praying for in the future. We pray for our children, our grandchildren that may not even exist yet. We pray for them. And one day we will gather together in heaven with those dear saints and hear about the fruit of our prayers. It's so encouraging to me. For those who are here this morning and you don't know people that well, you feel alone and uncared for, I want to invite you to come to our prayer meetings. Come to our prayer meetings. If you come, you will find work to do and people to love. Brothers and sisters, will you join me in praying for the supernatural work of God to happen in our midst? Will you join me in praying for the advancing gospel of Jesus Christ to be at work here in our little church in Round Rock, in the other churches in our area, in the other churches that we're affiliated with all the churches around the world that proclaim the gospel. Will you join me in praying for revival to affect our members, for the gospel to go forth from our lips, for the dead to be raised to life, for Christians to be strengthened in their faith? Will you join me, friends? Will you join me in praying together? Let's stop now. Just want to close by taking a few minutes. Once you, if you know the people around you, it can sometimes be intimidating. If you know the people around you, great. If not, just say hi real quick. Let's just take 2 minutes and pray together for the advancing gospel of Jesus Christ to shape our community and to have a great effect all around us now and in the years and decades to come. Let's take a few minutes to pray. We gather together this morning as your saints have done for thousands of years. We humble ourselves before you, Father. We say, great is our God. Worthy to be praised are you, O Lord. You are holy. You are worthy. You are awesome and majestic, greatly to be praised. We confess our need, Father. We confess our weakness. We confess our frailty and our limitations. And we thank you, Father, for your long suffering with us. We thank you for your steadfast love, which is better than life. We thank you, Father, for your grace and mercy working in our life. We thank you, God, that the songs that we sung earlier, whether we feel them this morning or not, for all those who are in Christ, they are true. Father, thank you. And now, Father, we pray that you would bless this church, that you would bless these prayers. God, I pray that you would spark a revival of prayer in our church. I pray that you would start with individuals praying privately and gathering together in small groups and gathering together in big groups, Father. I pray, God, that our church would be a praying church, dependent upon you, praying persistently, devoting ourselves to it, Father, praying corporately, together, Father. And Lord, as we do this, as we ask you to do great things, as we sit here in the calm before the storm, Father, we pray for the storm. We pray, Father, for your Spirit to work in our midst. We pray, Father, for you to form a community that displays the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we pray, God, that you would add to our numbers by conversions, Father. We pray, God, that you would add people to your household, that you would save some, that you would save many. But we need you to do these things, God. We are weak, intimidated, Father. We need you. So, Father, send your Spirit. Fill us afresh today. Let us leave here today, Father, encouraged, strengthened, with our faith built up, eager to see you at work. We love you, God, and we pray all of this because of your Son, Jesus, and through his precious and holy, awesome name.